This is Eugene Cambre, and we're going to put a presentation on today that has to do with what I call phones, drones, and camera bones. So it's going to be a lot of the basics of photography, and there's a lot of things that I have found that phone cameras do that a lot of people do not know, and I've asked around a number of friends and family if they know some of the subjects we're going to discuss today. And some of them were brand new to me too. Some of them were on my own telephone and I had no idea they were there. So we'll get this going. And the question would be, who's the best? Who has the best camera? Would it be a drone? Would it be the big camera? Would it be a cell phone? And still to this day, the big cameras still have an edge because they have so much resolution in their sensors, which is the key to getting a good picture. So megapixels and megabytes, we'll discuss that here in just a second. But the phones have caught up and done and are doing a spectacular job on photography. So what is the resolution of the human eye? Because we talk about resolution in a camera being, say, 5 megapixels, 50 megapixels. We're sitting at about 576 megapixels. And that's an extremely powerful camera in if we're talking about photography. So it's a camera of 50 megapixels can produce images that can be stretched out to the size of a barn. So it we also see life at a 13 millisecond frame rate. So as we look at objects and people and things, every 13 milliseconds, it's like we get a refresh in our brain. That's the speed at which they calculate we see things. But you take a 30-second time exposure of an object, especially in the evening, then that's 30,000 milliseconds of photons that are going to pile up on a sensor. And you can get some incredible editing from that, some excellent photos. So imagine your retina sitting close for 30 seconds, but it's collecting all the imagery and the photons, then your eyes would suddenly open up and receive all that imaging. You'd see some spectacular sights. So let's see if we can get a sense of direction about all these camera options and just look at the basics. So we won't go into big detail on each one, but with this being a video that's recorded, you can stop it at any time and check out things on the internet that I'm talking about for your review. So the cell phone cameras first landed in America in about year 2002. And all the manufacturers have been trying to make a better and better and better camera every output, every new installation of cameras. And the dawn of the smartphone started in about 2008. And the rise of social media made it important to have a good phone because everybody's trying to keep up with the Joneses. Just before the mobile cameras began taking most of the world's photos, they were taken on devices that were way larger than a cell phone. And they say, well, how is it possible that these things can take such great photos? How can they get them up to 200 megapixel resolution? Let's see. So we all kind of remember the brick. Well, nope, not all of us do remember the brick. People like me, look like me, remember the brick. And then there was the phones, cell phones with an antenna. Flip phones came along, and they're making a comeback. And we got folding screen phones, and they're doing a great job. So is there a question about which one's the best goes back to what do you really need? And here are the explosion of choices. And everybody is saying, I want a better battery life. I want storage, maximum storage. I need security. Make a better build. Faster processors, please. Better cameras, faster cameras. I like a certain brand and especially the price. I want a good price. So now they have cell phones that have up to 1 terabyte storage in the cell phone. And that doesn't include extra storage that you might be able to put in the form of a chip. And some of them have 6 cameras. And at this time, the Samsung Galaxy S23 Ultra is leading the pack on internal storage, and it sports a 200 megabyte camera. And it's running around $1,600. There's many, many other phones and brands out there that do an excellent job of photography, from quality pictures to fabulous editing features. So check out those functions and benefits that make the best choice for you.
Eugene, I had a question.
Yes.
On these cameras, out of curiosity, do you select the lens or do they take a photo of all of the images available and through the three different lenses?
Yeah, these different lenses will be, some of them will be like wide angle, extra wide angle. Some will be for video. Some will be for selfie. So they break these phone, cameras down with this each cell phone to do a different function. And there's one function that I'll discuss here shortly that they actually can use two cameras at the same time.
Okay, thank you.
You bet.
Yes, that questions.
Yeah. All right. So the phone camera power, what does it mean when you say megapixels? And the megapixels are going to detail how much your camera sensor can capture. The only thing that more megapixels will give you is the ability to enlarge and crop your photo. And that way that keeps the pixels from, makes them invisible and looks like a more seamless photo. And that thing is, that's also adjustable on many phones. The megabytes, that's the size of the picture that you just took or a file. So if you plan on printing a photo, and in a lot of cell phones, you take a picture, it might be under 1 megabyte. It might be 2 to 5 megabytes. It depends on the cell phone. But you can also take it and put it in another function called RAW, which we'll discuss shortly. And then your file gets a lot bigger. But you can also increase the size of your file if you lower your ISO, which allows a lot more light to come in or keeps it from coming in. You can also tell a higher resolution image by the size of their file. So if you see a 50 megabyte file, 90 megabyte file, that was taken from a pretty darn big camera. An image file that's less than a megabyte, you'll probably not have much use for that for high quality printing, unless it's going to be a very tiny print. A 5 megabyte photo can be printed to a much better size than a 1 megabyte. And using the pro or the manual mode of a camera can be huge in achieving these clear and high quality photos for enlarging prints. To edit a photo, I have found that is about 5 megabytes is the drop off. And you get below that, there's not much that editing software can do for it to create a large print. So people have flash on every camera. And the question is, should we use that flash? Well, in a lot of fashion photography, they do to eliminate shadows. So flash photos give a superior contrast. They bring out the detail and the tones that compared to a non-flash photo. That even accounts for the post-processing of a photo. So if you use flash, it can greatly improve the sharpness, color saturation of your photos and can remove some of those daytime facial shadows. If you want to make a more aesthetically interesting photo, try to flash. The flash will not go out very far. And there's times that you don't need it because the new cell phones have so much light gathering capability. It's just something to test on your individual cell phone. We're going to talk about the various camera modes, and this gets really thick. There's a lot of modes on these phones these days, and if you don't explore them, you know, you might be missing the boat. So it'll allow you to take photos and videos with great ease. You can also use different camera modes such as live focus, night mode, or super slow-mo to customize your shot or your video depending on the occasion. So we'll find out more about those, and you can find a lot of information online and in your phone manual. The online versions are much faster and easier to understand. So we'll start off with these various modes by discussing live focus, and these are going to be kind of bullet points. Once again, if you one of these modes interests you, then take a look at it online and find a tutorial or a video on it, and it'll get you a lot further. So live focus blurs the background of the photographer's of a photograph to help the foreground subject stand out. You can also use live focus. Yes.
We forgot to set some ground rules at the beginning. Will you accept questions during the, yes. Obviously you said mine, but as a general principle, can the, audience ask questions as you're proceeding along, or do you want to wait till the end?
No, they can ask while we're going, and or if they want to write it down and save it to the end.
Okay. So for the folks on Zoom, if you do have questions, just open up your mic and we'll hear you.
All right. So the next mode we'll talk about is slow motion. That allows you to record a video and then play it back up to 8 times slower than normal. Then there's super slow motion. And that plays your video back 32 times slower than your normal video and 4 times slower than videos taken with the slow motion feature. The panorama mode, it takes a bunch of images and connected to create one long photo. So if you have too much, if you move too much while you're panning these photos, you might end up with a crooked or distorted photograph. To avoid that, try to keep your hands as close to your chest as possible. Another one's called hyperlapse, and I have not seen this on a camera yet, on a phone yet. Mine may have, but I haven't seen it. But hyperlapse is a really cool feature that allows you to create your own time-lapse video. It records at various frame rates, which automatically adjusts to what you're recording. That's going to be an interesting one for people. So the pro mode puts the control in your hands so you get the very photo that you want. So you get to manually adjust your settings, such as the ISO, your shutter speed, and the exposure levels. Express your own style with filters or adjust the white balance settings to accommodate different lighting conditions. So if you get into a place where there's a lot of fluorescent light, then you can take a fluorescent feature and revert it back to normal. I know that in pro mode, you can also do some astrophotography if you do not have that feature on your phone. We'll talk about that in a minute, but it's amazing what these things can do at night under the pro mode. Then in video mode, that applies to the basic in-camera stabilization. So video mode files are named usually that VD and then VID and then some numbers after that, or MP4. And they can be viewed directly on any player, anything that plays it back. Pro video, that applies to the superior flow state stabilization, the horizon leveling, and the option to adjust the aspect ratio during editing. So pro video is kind of a new one onto the scene. Panorama, we know about this particular, as this is called panorama, it's a unique feature that allows you to physically pan the camera from left to right or tilt the camera up and down. And the capture of the camera capturing 180 or 360 degrees of panorama images and seamlessly stitch them all together for you. There's a food mode that lets you take pictures that emphasize the vivid colors that you can get from foods. And a lot of restaurants use that, and they post their photos on Google Maps and advertisements right out of a cell phone. On the night mode, you can take photos almost in the dark. So it's perfect for nighttime shooting, and the night mode will produce vivid images without the camera's flash. If you have a newer phone model, it'll come with super bright night or ultra bright night technology for precise pictures and dim lighting. It's surprising when you try that how much light there is out there that you don't even see that this phone will pick up. Here's another one, director's view. How many people have heard of that one? So you can use a director's view by itself with no selfie camera, or with dual recording, which lets you simultaneously record with the rear camera and the selfie camera at the same time. The director's view also gives you the option to switch between the rear camera lenses. That's kind of complicated, so that's something you may want to play with. I had never heard of that one.
I've seen videos on YouTube. Yeah. Give you that impression that we're
able to. Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's amazing what's on our phones that a lot of people just don't know. Now, Expert Raw, and I love this one, but it's an innovative camera app, and Samsung Galaxy has. I'm not sure about the others, but that can provide raw files that can be professionally filmed and edited later so that you can take high quality HDR photos, which is high dynamic range, and then edit them in more detail. The Expert Raw app can be downloaded from the Galaxy Store. Also, this mode allows for astrophotography capabilities. I personally did this one the other night, and it really surprised me at what it would come up. I could see the Milky Way galaxy core and expose it. So this app, once you open that up, you have to do a few things that is explained on the internet. And there's a little, what looks like a little star map up in the right-hand corner. You tap on that, and now you're ready to do either 4-minute, 7-minute, or maybe up to a 10-minute exposure of the stars and the galaxy, and they show up. So this is the time of year between April and the end of September that you can see the Milky Way galaxy core and catch it on a cell phone. And in the expert raw file, you can edit that and really bring out some colors you wouldn't believe on a cell phone. Here comes portrait video. So the camera allows you to capture pictures or videos where the background is blurred and the subject stands out clearly. We just talked about that on portrait, but now there's portrait video. So you can also apply a background effect and edit it after taking a picture. And a single take, that's what most people use. That'll capture multiple shots at once, or it can, of your family, your pets, or even yourself. The camera's artificial intelligence will decide which angles to snap so that all your photos come out crisp and bright. Single take will capture a variety of still shots and video clips with pre-applied filters and effects. There are people that have said that once they found out this single take app, that's all they use. But again, the fun of it is to play around with it, see what you come up with. So Apple and Samsung do have astrophotography apps. They capture the night skies, including the Milky Way core and the Northern Lights. This is usually something you have to download, and it'll coordinate with your particular phone. Definitely check out all the information that's online. Those tutorial videos will take you a long way, and you can achieve some spectacular results. So not all phones can do this, but you can work with most phones to get some nice results by choosing the highest ISO setting, the slowest shutter speed, and play around with those and other settings to get a decent night sky shot. And also, you might put that phone on, let's say, like your windshield where it's pointing up and there's no wind blowing, so it doesn't move your car around, and or a tripod that can hold a cell phone.
How do the new cell phones handle the noise from the high ISO?
They don't do a very good job. And that's where that file is probably going to be about 5 megabytes. And so it could be up to 10 megabytes. Now at 10 megabytes, you will have to, for example, like Lightroom has a number of features, including the new denoise function. And it's going to be probably pretty heavy because you need 50 to 90 megabytes really to work that noise out. So now some people have said that it doesn't pick it up because there's not enough resolution. Other people say it's really noisy. So it's just going to depend probably on how clean that lens is on the camera and how much firepower it's got. But that's a great question, because some of them just are better left alone, and some of them you just can't edit.
Right. You can end up with a beautiful picture like that with a DSLR, but I don't know, with a high ISO on a cell phone might be a little messy. And
right. And with the cell phone taking up to 10 minutes to take a photo, and I did it, and it looked pretty good. I should have probably downloaded a photo on there, but I didn't blow it up to see. And that's when here comes the noise. So
yes.
I'll talk about that a little bit, and just, I think it towards the end, but yeah, that's a great question. I've got a feeling it's no match for a DSLR or a mirrorless. Just like when people say, well, look at this moonshot, and they zoom it up on the phone. It looks good until you try to print it, and it just looks like a bunch of oranges on a table. So let's see here. This is one that was done with a DSLR. But you could get something on a cell phone that's going to be kind of like this. You'll see some noise in this one. And all that can be cleared out with editing software, but you'd get a 10-minute exposure, and then you can take a flashlight and just kind of hit the lighthouse just like for part of a second or a second. You can illuminate the whole thing. But you could do something like this with a cell phone. So there's a lot of possibilities. You have to use your curiosity and your imagination and see where they cross paths.
Was that in each one of yours?
That one is mine. This one was not. That was one from a cell phone. You'll see a lot of noise on that one. So this one's mine.
So was this particular one here, the one at the lighthouse, was that post-processed too?
That's post-processed, right?
Okay.
So it's interesting. There's rarely do I ever use, I don't have a filter. I don't use any filters, but you do have to work on the colors in Lightroom. to bring them out. They're there. You just have to figure out how to bring them out and darken the sky at the same time. And this was done with a cell phone. That's not mine, but I have, actually, that is mine. I take that back. That is mine. I'm sorry. This one's not a cell phone.
Is that post-processed?
This is post-processed. If you saw the original one, the interesting thing is the original photo, which I wish I would have put on here, could show you. I'll do another seminar on editing. But you look at the one there, it's almost kind of like a twilight or a dusk look to it, where there's the sky is kind of lit up. But all those stars are there, but you couldn't possibly see them. So then when you start throwing the editing functions to it, all the stars start coming out. And this one, I did not do much with the noise, just to show that this might be what it would look like on a cell phone with a lot of the noise. They say they may be very hard to get rid of. But I could take and work this one where it clean out all that and make it look even more spectacular. You might try your hand at the Northern Lights. So once again, you have to just get out there and then play with the settings, take a shot, and then you'll immediately see, well, that one didn't work. Let me increase my ISO. Let me increase, one of my phones goes up to 30 minutes. So you're going to get the Northern Lights with something like that. So there's more out there, but my mind just can't take any more. We could go on and on and on. But that covered a lot of the modes there, the things that people didn't know. So, hope you take the time to explore some of these options and see what kind of selections are at your disposal when making a phone buying decision. Sometimes you got nothing else to do at night, but on these cold winter nights, just play around with that phone. That's what these guys would love to have had a cell phone back in those days. Well, this drone time. And so you got to kind of save up some money for this one. If not, I'd like to be your friend. But this one's about $64 million. And that's usually at the high end of the military drone. I don't have any plans on getting this one anytime soon. So there's all kinds of drones out there, from bi, tri, quad, penta, hexa, and octocopter. When you start getting into the ones with 5 to 8 blades, there are a lot of commercial people using those, and they do some high-end work, but they go up on high-power lines and do some specific work for that. Some of them have different kinds of cameras on there. So I'm going to stick with my quadcopter in the top right. This was taken by a friend of mine in New York City with his drone. If you want to look him up, his name is Noel Thomas, and he does unbelievable work. Some of his videos that he has done with drones and land cameras are the Milky Way galaxy, and he does time lapse. Some of them have 500,000 photos in a 30-second video. But this kind of a thing is possible with the drone. You get it up in the air, and with these good lenses and the 1-inch sensors, they can pull in a lot of data, especially if you shoot it in RAW and then post-process. But some of them look just like that when you're looking on your phone or their monitor. It looks just like that. And so it's not hard. A lot of them you don't even have to touch with a good drone. And, if you get a drone, keep it geofenced. Keep it from taking off in areas that are dangerous to air traffic and military bases. A lady I knew down in Florida went around her warning and got it up in the air. She was on the beach, and Fort Walton was right down the road. And suddenly it appeared on her monitor, U.S. Department of Navy. It took control of her drone as she watched it and sent it out into the Gulf of Mexico, never to be seen again. And she said she didn't go knock on the door and ask for it back. She could have gotten a lot of trouble. Be ever vigil. The birds during flight, always look around. I recommend you always look around. I've been attacked about 3 times, and the fourth one would have been a bald eagle, but it kind of looked at it, and it turned and went on about its business. It's like, I probably run into one of those before. They don't taste good. But the Dutch police are training eagles to pull drones out of the sky where the flying is prohibited. And also, watch out for jumping dogs. I saw a photo of a dog jumping up in the air because it was too low and it wanted that drone and got a mouthful of it. So, always kind of pay attention to your surroundings when you're using a drone. And that, what does that have to do with drone cameras? Well, you won't have a drone camera if the seagulls get it. This is a view that I took up in Florida. And it's just absolutely amazing when you get that drone up in the air, what you can see and why it may be something that you want to look into getting. So the very best videos and still photos using a drone, a gimbal is a must. So if you get one, I would highly recommend that you get one that has a gimbal and either two axis or three axis, and it completely stabilizes your footage. And I was taking a video of my drone, and it was going full speed, and it was tilted forward, and I brought it to an abrupt stop, and you could watch the drone, and it completely tilted back up in the air and stopped. When you play the video back, there's absolutely no indication that anything was done, set perfectly still. That's an example of a gimbal-mounted drone, just another example where it's very obvious to see what it looks like. So you got high-definition cameras and embedded cameras, thermals, infrared, and other image capture systems that can be put on a drone. And by the way, if you remember The Shining, that was one of the first early examples of somebody putting a camera on a gimbal when they were going through the ice maze. And because everybody said, how did that camera get through there? Somebody had it on a big gimbal and was carrying the camera around as they filmed them chasing each other through the snow maze. Perfect example of how smooth a gimbal is. So anyway, these drones have come a long way. Went from HD to 4K, and that's a huge leap when you go from 1080 to 4K, and now they're going on up to 8K. Maybe the problem with 8K is that when you play that back on a TV, you probably can't see it because of the refresh rate, but it's still, you'll see some difference. So a lot of YouTube videos are out there to help you sort out the differences in the selection of which drone and camera combo to get. This is a steampunk drone. I couldn't find it on the market, so I'm not going to buy this one. But if you get one that has at least a 4K lens and a gimbal, you are off to an incredible start, no matter what it is. And this one, this probably happened to about everybody. It says you crashed it on your crashed it immediately. So might be best to buy a cheap one first, test it out, get used to it. You know, they go anywhere from $20 to $60. You get a pretty decent one, you know, to play with. And that'll introduce you to your expensive one if you get someday. And yeah, when you land your drone for the first time, makes you feel pretty good. And of course, yeah, we'll just put up another little drone regulation right over here. You got to keep those things updated and your knowledge as well. So you don't have to have a pilot's license, but if you get one, you know, it gives you a lot of information as to the do's and the don'ts of drones. So if you have a drone that says magnetic interference or it's not wanting to go up, you're probably near an airport or a restricted area and you don't even know it. So, you know, are you ready for this kind of photography? I sent the drone up and got this up in the air right at the sunset and edited all these trees to where they turned white. They were white, but I had to bring it out in post-editing. But this is the kind of stuff you can get if you have a drone to get it up in the air and see what's around you. Another example, this is the Presqu'ile Island. So, you know, definitely keep your drone under 400 feet. And I talked to a lady pilot one time. She says, how high will they go? I said, 400 feet. She says, good, because we can't go under 500 feet. And there's a guy in Russia that put us up 26,000 feet. But it probably was nobody flying around there at that time. But so it's camera time. Can you tell by the photo that it's camera time? So a lot of them have so many bells and whistles, and we could go on forever talking about cameras, but we'll just talk about the basics. And wow, you want to talk about the basics? And here's 12 different kinds of cameras for photography. So we'll just do some bullet points on each one of these. Just so again, if you get interested in one, you can go back or pick a topic. Go check it out on the internet to get a whole lot more information. So there's your compact digital, also known as the point and shoot. And they're a very simple design and they're still used a lot because there's just all you have to do is just kind of point and shoot and they'll have a flash and they're still out there. So the phone has probably replaced most of these, but they're still out there. And there's called a bridge camera. So with a bridge camera, you do get a zoom lens that will go in and out of the camera. It's a little bit bigger body, to say the least. So that's an in-between camera for one that has interchangeable lens and the point and shoot. So they do a really good job. Then you got your DSLR, digital single lens reflex. And so it combines the optics and the mechanisms of a single lens reflex camera with the solid state image sensor and digitally records them onto the sensor. And this is, I don't know of anything that's going to replace these other than the mirrorless, and the mirrorless are making their way into the marketplace more and more. And there's the difference. So if you look at the DSLR, look at the size of that body, and then you look at the mirrorless, they're a lot smaller, they weigh less. They've got interchangeable lenses as well. And there are definitely some things that you like with the mirrorless and not like with the mirrorless. Same with the DSLR. So if you're thinking about spending some money, moving up into either one of those categories, be sure to find out, hey, does that thing have lenses that'll fit it that aren't necessarily a Nikon? Because right now, Nikon, as far as I know, will not allow the Tamron or the Sigma or other brands fit that mirrorless. Whereas my DSLR camera has a lot of firepower and it'll fit all kinds of brands. There's a medium format camera. Now, a lot of people might remember these in the old days. That's a 120 film size versus the 35 millimeter that you just saw that, of that scale. But these have a bigger digital imaging sensor. And while they run up in, you know, 6,000 is probably where they started. A regular one's probably 13,000. And who knows what they go up to the more gadgets you get. There's GoPro. That's called an action camera. They're small. They're rugged. They're waterproof. And they're just designed to put on the front of your canoe or your head or wherever you're, whatever you're doing. They'll just get right in there and start capturing videos and photos for you in places that regular cameras and smartphones just can't go. So GoPro is one of the more popular brands. There are others. You got the 360-degree camera. So it's got 180-degree looking forward and rear-facing lenses that captures everything around it at one time. And if you've ever seen a video, I have a friend that rides a motorcycle, and I asked him, how did you get that drone to follow you that close? And he goes, that's my 360-degree camera. It doesn't make sense, but you are actually seeing him from like 3 feet behind his motorcycle. You see the street, you see the motorcycle, you see in front, and it's going down the road due to one of these 360-degree cameras. It's incredible. And then, of course, you got your film camera that are just about completely gone. Films, I'm not even going to say it's making a comeback, but there is some interest that's come back, but it's definitely not going to take over the market. The old instant camera, that goes back quite a few years back to the 60s. Where you can probably even earlier than that, but you snap a picture and then out it comes. It's, the little print comes out of the device. They're kind of fun for kids. So a smartphone, that's a mobile phone that can capture photographs and record videos using one or more built-in digital cameras. Can also immediately send things wirelessly and conveniently. Broadcast that to your smart TV. Tough cameras. I don't think anybody I know has got one. And you just hardly ever see one, but these things are just darn near indestructible. But they are point and shoot, autofocus, auto exposure, and they have the video capability. But probably the military uses stuff like this. But I've never actually seen one, but they are one. They can probably throw them off a cliff and they'll still work. But they're out there. And the digital cinema camera, that's what you see. TV stations use these a lot. And just a movie camera that can do digital storage instead of film. And so next are some basic camera functions and how they relate to the final picture. So like this photo, I used shutter priority. And by that, I mean, I'm telling the shutter exactly what I want it to do. And I knew that between 1/5 and 1/8 of a second on water, moving water, you're going to get a picture that looks kind of like this, where the water turns silky. But if you take a photo with that kind of a setting, then you can move that, dial that shutter speed around to get less or more of an effect like that. So shutter priority is where you take a picture manually, you designate that shutter speed And now this is another example of one that is about 1/6 of a second. So if you did it 1/10 of a second, then that water will look more like horsehair. And if you did it like for a longer exposure time, it'll just get smoother and silkier to the point where it just looks like one body of water. So when you do go to shutter, the camera will choose the other settings like your ISO and other things to adjust for your shutter speed control. There's another example where I told the camera, I want this thing to shoot at 1/1250th of a second, which made that water stand still. Cool thing about that kind of shutter priority, you can sit there and take the photo, immediately see the results, and dial your shutter speed up or down to get the desired result. And it was this speed is where I got that look I was looking for. And we'll talk about aperture priority. This is what I use a lot, and a lot of people do. So when I go out, I want something in focus, or I don't want things in focus. So I use aperture priority. Like I want a picture of a butterfly sitting on a flower. I just want that thing in focus. So I just simply dial my f-stop to 1.4 or some really small number. And just about everything before and after that butterfly is out of focus. This is also really cool, say at weddings where you want to concentrate on a couple and you put everything before and after out of focus. You go all the way to F8, for example, then everything's getting more and more in focus. And Ansel Adams was a member of the F64 club, and everything is super sharp. And I think cameras go up to F128, but I don't have anything like that. But that's what I use. I go out, make sure I want everything in focus. I roll it up high, and the camera takes care of the other settings. The f-stop and that. There's an example of a 5.6. So I got the chipmunk in focus, and you see before and after that is not. And so it changes if you have a zoom lens or a 20 millimeter lens. So like I say, with digital, in the digital world, you take a few photos and dial it in, move it around, and you get exactly what you want in a very short period of time. And you can do that on cell phones also. In program mode, you're going to pretty much select both the shutter speed and the aperture. And it just really does everything else. So it does great with low light. But the camera might set something at a 30th of a second and F4, but it decides pretty much for you. In manual mode, and this is what I do at night, I tell that camera exactly what shutter speed I want and what aperture I want. And so something like this, you could do one of these, it might be 30 seconds long, but the stars are going to start streaking. So I limit my camera to, I'll tell it's going to be between like 2 and 10 seconds, maybe 15. There is a 500 rule. That doesn't really apply as much to digital anymore. So if I was you, might start off at a 6 to 10 second mode and dial in your ISO to bring in more light or reduce it. So in the case of this moon, getting it this crisp and sharp, it took me a while to figure it out. But you got to go completely and totally manual on your camera. You got to turn off your vibration control or some similar function like that. Then you want to turn on your live focus on your camera, and you'll see a little magnifying glass that has a plus sign in it, and you push that between 2, 3, and 4 times, and you'll see it digitally zoom in on the moon to the point you're looking in craters. At that point, your camera still sees like this image, but then you micro fine tune your focus ring and watch the craters come into focus, and boom, you've got this kind of a shot. When I posted this, I had a lot of friends that do moonshots, and how in the world did I do it? And it was the live focus that was the game changer. Works on a daytime too, if you're not sure something's in focus. Well, one night I took 900 photos and got back 900 moonshots. We're out of focus. There was something wrong. Went out the next night and thinking, this is before I knew about live focus, but still, it turns out that the lens hood was, my camera was warm from being in the house. It's cool outside, and it sets up a heat wave, kind of like a mirage that you see on the highway. I don't know what made me think to take it off, but I took it off, and it immediately could tell that everything was back in focus. So that's something you may have to take off or leave your lens, camera and lens out 2-4 hours to get it acclimated before you start shooting some serious pictures. This one was shot with a Nikon D850. This is shot at f1.4, which brings in tons of light. I use a ISO 6400 and with a for 6 seconds long on a 20 millimeter lens. And you have to edit these things, you know, because when you shoot in RAW, you won't ever post a RAW photo. It doesn't look right. But then I wanted to turn this into a JPEG. And this is what I was able to get. And I can actually go in here and I can change this photo and make that Milky Way galaxy core show more colors of the rainbow. They're there. This is just what I wanted for this particular one. And I didn't bring them out. But I didn't create that Milky Way galaxy core, Photoshop it, because I don't know how to use it. But that's the kind of stuff that's out there for you to pick up. As a matter of fact, the lighthouse was kind of a greenish color because some of the lighting around it. So with Lightroom, I took and swabbed it with the cursor, and it sees it as an object. And now it captures that as an object, and now you get to edit that. Sometimes you can use the subject button, and it'll find it. But an object narrows it down to just one thing. And the different kinds of photo editing processes out there, you know, Lightroom, Photoshop Express, Snapspeed, Prisma, BazArt, PhotoFox, VSCO, and PicArt. There's just some of them. And they really do an incredible job. Some of them are free. Some of them you pay. I pay like $10 a month for the Adobe Lightroom Suite, which has Photoshop and other stuff. And it's stunning what you can do with a photo. And Ansel Adams, you know, he heavily edited every single photo we ever published. And it might take him up to 2 weeks to complete his editing, which one sold for $68,000. And he even said, you'd never buy one of my photos. If I was just to take a photo and print it, you would never buy it. I have to edit them for you to like it. So you might be totally amazed what you can pull out of one of your photos because the camera sees things that you cannot. And I've dug into my files and pulled up some things that I had no idea what I had till I edited it. So summer, spring, winter, spring, summer, fall. I hope that this webinar has kind of helped you take your understanding of photography to a different level. And I thank you so much for your attendance. And this is my email if you have any questions.
Thank you, Eugene. Does anybody online have any questions? If so, just unmute yourself and ask your question. Thank you, Eugene. That was a great summary of a whole lot of information.
Thank you.
That's all I say.
All right.
You made it sound more simple than it might be.
I tried.
Okay. If no one else has any questions, thank you for joining the presentation, and we'll try to get this on our YouTube channel sometime soon.